Very good evening to everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome all of you for the fourth day session of fifth day event of AIIMS 2021. Now I request Dr. T. Kaleshwari ma'am to introduce our resource person.
Thank you, Sangeeta. Good evening, everyone. It is my pleasure and privilege to introduce the speaker of this fourth session, Dr. M. Mary Shanti Rani, assistant professor in our department. She did PhD in computer science and has more than 15 years of teaching experience. She has nearly 70 publications in international journals and conferences. Her area of research are image compression, information security, biometrics, computational biology, and deep learning. Her Google Scholar citation is 225 with H index 9 and I10 index 7. She has served in various academic committees in designing the curriculum for BSc and MCA courses as well. She has also served as a reviewer of peer-reviewed international journals and conferences. She is a life member of Indian Society for Technical Education. She has authored one book, two books chapter, and edited two book volumes. She has the credit of being the Associate Project Director of UGC Indo-US 21st Knowledge Initiative Project and Co-Principal Investigator of Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya National Mission Teaching Project. She is the lead coordinator of Griha, a Gandhigram research incubator on healthcare and agriculture applications, and has organized many workshops and training programs on artificial intelligence as part of this Leading India.AI project, a nationwide initiative for popularizing artificial intelligence and skilling all over India. With this, I welcome you once again, madam. Now the session is yours. Thank you, madam. Thank you all.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Kaleshwari, for the nice introduction. So I take this opportunity to thank our beloved madam, Dr. P. Shanmugavadivu, HOD, and chair of this national workshop for giving me this opportunity. And also I welcome all the participants. So good afternoon, everyone. So my topic is auto encoders demystified. So before that, I would like to give a small overview of a small introduction on artificial intelligence. So we all know that artificial intelligence is emerging as a powerful domain, enabling machines to act and think like human beings, that is, make decisions like human beings. So it has given plenty of opportunities to innovate, that is, replace traditional methods using automated methods with computer vision, robotics, natural language processing, etc. So, we have a lot of opportunities to do research in this area. So that's our motive behind the theme, choosing the theme for this national workshop. Now I shall get into my business. I'll try to share my PPT. Hope I am audible, right, for all of you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Are you able to see my presentation?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is it bigger, Sangeeta?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. So, my topic is auto encoders demystified. I'll try my best to give us an overview of auto encoders. So, my the outline of my presentation is given. That is, I'll talk about introduction and then encoders, and about the architecture of autoencoders, and then finally is application sun sample code. So we all know what is artificial intelligence and why artificial intelligence. As I said, it is emerging as a powerful domain recently because of the availability of advanced computing power and availability of data, or we can say it's data explosion, and then development of new algorithms and applications. So now it has taken off very faster. So what is artificial intelligence? It is an area of computer science that emphasizes the creation of intelligent machines that work and react like humans. So it also represents the theory and development of computer systems to perform tasks requiring human intelligence. So what kind of problems can be solved by artificial intelligence? So let us first differentiate or distinguish between AI problems and non-AI problems. So all non-AI problems, that is, it could be programmed or structured algorithmic problems. That is, you can write an algorithm directly so that it could be executed. And then what AI problems are totally unstructured. So it is very difficult to write algorithm. That is, if you write an algorithm for a particular problem, but for the same problem, we have to write a different one. Say, for example, if you want to, if you are writing writing a program for identifying fraud or theft, so we'll be focusing on writing steps to identify the burglars following a traditional way. But we all know that nowadays the burglars are using different methods, different ways to get into your house. So it's just a simple. So likewise for every problem, so for problems which are unstructured, we are not able to write a single algorithm. So such kind of problems are called as AI problems. So if you compare non-AI problems and AI problems, so machines can solve non-AI problems better compared to human beings. But in AI problems, human beings outperform machines in solving these problems. So now we are striving for outperforming human beings using artificial intelligence. So again, the list of AI problems. So problems where there is no deterministic algorithm, which don't have a fixed solution. So and then our goalposts keep changing, like spam emails. So if you write, if you try to find a solution for identifying spam email, then we will get a different type of email, and then similarly financial fraud. So and also problems where solutions are individual specific or time dependent. So individual specific varies with the individual. So right, giving a solution for one individual will not cannot be applied for another one. So these kind of problems, say for example, prediction based on past and existing patterns, prediction of share prices, these are all unpredictable. So these kind of problems can be very well solved. These are all the problems that give scope for applying artificial intelligence. So recognizing there is a handwriting recognition is another challenging problem which could be solved using artificial intelligence. Now for applying artificial intelligence, the basic requirement is learning. So everyone will just learn, we keep on learning new things. So generally, what is the basic idea, or what is the principle of learning? Now I have shown you two images, right? So if you see the images, if you have already known, immediately you will answer. Say the second one is a peacock, and then the first one is the Mysore Palace. So how are you able to answer the questions? Either you should have seen the peacock earlier, or you might have got information from your parents or friends about the appearance of a peacock, you might have seen in the textbooks. Otherwise, you will not be able to answer whether this image is a peacock. Similarly for Mysore Palace. So if you have already visited, or if you have studied in your textbooks, history or geography book, right? Or your parents might have parents or friends might have informed about the appearance of the Mysore Palace. So just hearing this information, our brain builds a model. So a peacock. So what would be the appearance of a peacock? What is its color? What are the other attributes? Similarly, the palace, how it would look like, right? So just seeing and hearing, our brain will build its own model, right? So once it has built a model, for the next time when you show or when you visit, your brain immediately recognizes that it is that particular object, that it is a peacock or it's a palace, right? Or it is zebra. So this capability, this human capability of identifying things. So this is a kind of intelligence. So learning is a way of acquiring intelligence, right? So that is the basic principle of learning. So as I told you, so your brain builds a model out of what it sees. Whenever it sees an object, what it registers, right? So how it builds a model based on some descriptors, that is, that attributes or some features that describe that particular object. Say, for example, here I have shown you two images again, a brown horse and then another one is zebra. So if I just give you only the outline, that is, so I have given only the boundary or the edges. But just by looking at the edges, you will not be able to answer that it is a zebra or a horse. We need more descriptors or features that describe that particular object, right? So in case of zebra, I could say the shape. So I must know the shape, and it is white. It has stripes, black and white stripes. So if it has black and white stripes, then it is a zebra. And if it is a different color, then it is a horse. So these are all features. That is, the features are the descriptors that help you to identify an object, right? So only then you'll be able to understand. So learning is a way of understanding intelligence. That is, capability to acquire and apply knowledge. So we are learning abstractions from data. That's a simple example. Just by looking at the zebra, I just learned some abstractions. Oh, it looks like this, the shape. I am memorizing the shape, and then it's memorizing the texture or the color, and then the unique stripes on it. So that is learning abstractions. So that helps you to identify the object. So machine learning. So the machine learning is a branch of artificial intelligence concerned with the design and development of algorithms that allow computers to learn and evolve behaviors based on this data. So just to give the definition of machine learning, I gave you the examples. Okay. So some of the machine learning applications, we have face detection. If you are given image patches, then your machine learning algorithm should identify whether it is a face or not face, and then character recognition processing. Suppose if you give pixels as the input, then your machine learning algorithm should output the various tissue types. And then similarly in business analysis, given the transactions, it should be, your algorithm should classify it as whether you can approve the credit or and then it could be used for whether fraud detection, etc. So in business analysis, we can have, given a set of transactions, it could be used for credit approval, fraud detection, target marketing, and more. So basically, a machine learning framework is defined as, say, y is equal to f of x. So f is the prediction function. In any classification problem, so first the model, so the classifier builds a model by studying the characteristics of the data. So here, let's consider that supervised learning. So we have a prediction function and then you access the given image feature, Y will be the output. Y is the label, class label. So generally, whether it's machine learning or deep learning, the data set will be divided into two sets, that is the training and testing. So both are disjoint sets. So we'll be training the model, we'll be learning the model using training set, and then we'll be using the test set. So these are the disjoint set, which is not present in the training set. So we use the examples in the test set to assess the accuracy performance of the model. So given a training set with the labeled examples, we just estimate the prediction function. So the function is learned such that we minimize the prediction error. We minimize the difference between the input and the output. So once you have trained the model such that the error is, we have minimized the error, then it could be used using the test samples. So we have different types of learning. There are four types. The popular types are supervised learning, unsupervised learning, semi-supervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So supervised learning, as you all know, that we, the data set comes along with the labels. So we know the data along and also the class label and also its class label. But in unsupervised learning, we just get the raw data with no prior knowledge about the data. So the algorithms, unsupervised learning algorithm, will find the characteristics and then it will cluster or it will group the data based on the similarity that exists between them. So that is a basic idea of unsupervised learning. And then semi-supervised learning, here we include some labeled, it's a mix of labeled and unlabeled inputs. So reinforcement learning, we just learn the model learns through a set of reactions. Say for example, if I am preparing a new recipe, if there is a new dish today, so I'll just serve to my family members and then based on the feedback, I just improve my cooking the same dish in the next during the next time. So that is reinforcement. We just rewarding from a set of feedback. So it's the types of learning: supervised, unsupervised, and this third one is semi-supervised. So unsupervised learning. Actually, they learn better representations than supervised learning because they are working with data sets without the target variable. So they just uncover hidden patterns just by looking at the data set. They just analyze. They use some similarity or dissimilarity between the data and then group them. And then say, for example, customers, if you are given a transaction sales the market database, you can group the customers based on their interest, based on their buying patterns. So say, for example, our algorithm may group them based on their buying pattern or the types of items they buy. Suppose you can have, so probably may have customers who buy electronic items frequently, right? And then other who are interested in cosmetics. So our algorithm will group the customers based on their interests, so which will be useful for targeted marketing. So, it could be used for exploratory data analysis because we have no knowledge about the data. So we try to explore the data. So that is exploratory data analysis. And then based on the data, we can generate new examples. So we'll discuss data. So data generation, art generation are all applications of neural networks. So again, it's what are the tasks that come under unsupervised learning? That is association rule, clustering, compression, dimensionality reduction, data generation. So these are some applications where unsupervised learning is implemented. So here, the objective is to explore the data and find the hidden structure or the hidden patterns. So we all know the machine learning structure. Just I go faster because these are all some preliminary. I just want to give an introduction for people who have no prior knowledge on this. So it's a machine learning structure. Will be the input will be a set of documents, images or sounds. So that is feature extraction will be done, and the features are fed to machine learning algorithm. So based on the features, the machine learning algorithm builds a model. So that will be tested with a new text or document. So the output of this machine learning structure will be the class label, like likelihood or cluster ID or this, depending upon the application. So just to make you understand the difference between supervised and unsupervised learning, we have, so this just a pictorial representation. So in unsupervised, we just give both the data as well as the corresponding labels. So the model will predict whether it is an apple. So based on this, it is trained, and then if it sees a new apple image, it just classifies or just says that it is an apple. But in case of unsupervised learning, we just give a mix of data without any labels. So the model just uncovers the patterns or uncovers the characteristics, and based on that, it classifies. There are many applications of this unsupervised learning, like clustering, anomaly detection, recommender system, data compression, dimensionality reduction, data generation. So you all know the use of clustering. I gave you an example, clustering, grouping similar data, that is clustering. So anomaly detection, when you cluster the data into clusters, so there will be some data objects which are far from the group, from the clusters. So the distance will be larger from, they don't belong to any one of the groups. So we call it as an outlier. So suppose we have considered the our bank transactions. Suppose if one transaction involves huge amount of money transfer, then it is an anomaly. So normally we don't transfer transfer money in crores. But if one transaction exists like that, then it will be considered as an anomaly. So that deviates from the normal behavior of the data. Outlier is one that deviates from the normal behavior of other data objects. And then recommender system, just by studying the characteristics of the clusters, or we know the characteristics of each cluster. So you say, if in this example, can have the customers or persons having similar interests. So all customers with similar interests. So if one customer buys a new item, then that could be recommended to the other, to another user of the same group or of similar interest. So like a book or recommending a movie of to people of the same interest. And then data compression is one important application, because nowadays we are transmitting a huge amount of data digitally. So for transmissions, just to reduce the transmission and storage costs, we need to compress it, so to save bandwidth. So that is another important application. So dimensionality reduction, data generation. So I think in the first talk, Professor Deepak showed one example, how to generate data. So these are all fake images. Just by, we are able to generate new images from the available data. Now, so far we discussed what is machine learning. Now, deep learning. Deep learning is also a type of artificial intelligence, but it is a variant of machine learning, which provides that it provides a deeper insight. So we just get multiple abstractions from the data. So that is deep. Deep specifies the number of layers, number of times we abstract data, number of abstractions that are derived from the data. So normally deep learning is done through artificial neural networks. So this kind of deep learning applications are well suited for prediction and detection and generation. So we use that could be generated based on past and existing patterns. Now, I may ask, what is the difference between machine learning and deep learning? So, machine learning, feature extraction is a separate process, but deep learning, it's a black box. Just you give the raw input, everything is done by the deep learning network. That is feature extraction and the classification, everything is done, we get the output. Whereas in machine learning, feature extraction is a separate process. So this we already discussed the applications of machine learning and deep learning. So the fundamental technique that is we use in deep learning is artificial neural network. So we all know that it is inspired by the biological nervous system. So it has a set of processing units which we call it as neurons. So the neurons communicate with each other by sending signals through the weighted connections. So you can see the representation. So this we have the neurons that is similar to dendrites in our brain nervous system. So the input from the neurons are summed up, and if the sum exceeds a particular value, then that particular neuron is fired. So we call it as a threshold. So the neuron fires if its activation is greater enough to activate it. So that is the basic function of a neural model. So it receives input from other neurons, changes its internal state based on its input. It resembles the biological neuron. So where the biological neuron receives input through dendrites, and it sends its output through a long thin strand called axon. So this ANN works. So just it's a repetition of all the other lectures. So I want to give an overview. So we have the inputs, the input nodes, the neurons. So each neuron correspond to a particular feature in the input data. So the weights give the importance of each feature. So the weights we assign weight to each input node. So the weighted connection, so we multiply the input value with its weight. So the summation, and then the summation is the summed up value we just apply an activation function to produce the output. So we have different types of activation functions. So we can use it depending upon the application. So normally any neural network will have three types of layers: input layer, hidden layer, and output layer. So the input layer, all the inputs are fed through this layer. Hidden layer is responsible for extracting the required features, and then the output layer produces the data after processing is made available at the output layer. So features, there are so many. The features vary with different types of applications. If the problem is predicting house prices, then the features would be number of rooms, house area, air pollution, etc. So likewise, for example, if it is cancer detection, then we need all these features like lump thickness, cell size, cell shape, etc. As we discussed in the first slide, that is the features or descriptors of each object, which help them to identify. So for each category or for each application, we have a different set of features. So for we have to give weightage to those features. Suppose if you want to purchase a house, if you give priority to the house area, then that will be given more weight than the other features. So these features are very much important in the learning process. So weights correspond to each feature. They denote how much the feature matters in the model. So higher weight a particular feature means that it's more important. So it contributes more to the outcome of the model. Now, generally, in artificial neural networks, the weights are initialized randomly. So the model network itself learns. So that is the whole process. So we just initialize the weights, and then the neural network will just iterate through by minimizing the loss function, and then this is done by optimization of the weights. So it is iterative optimization of weights. And then for any neural network, we'll be having a special node called bias. So this bias is used to offset, that is, they are tuned alongside weights by learning algorithms. So it's a way of normalizing the weights. So each layer will have a bias node. And then how the neural network works. So this backpropagation, we call it as a backpropagation because at the output layer, we get the output. So the output is compared with the input. So the difference between the output and the input is the error. So depending upon the magnitude of the error, this error is propagated backwards. So that is the backpropagation algorithm. It adjusts the weights of the neural network so as the loss is minimized. So that is done by optimizing the hyperparameters. Especially we adjust the weights. So the weights are adjusted in such a way that the mean squared error or binary cross entropy error in case of binary inputs, so it's minimized. So the network iteratively optimizes the parameters so that it results in minimum loss. Now, so far we discussed. So, what are the basic principles or basic idea underlying this neural network or deep learning? So, autoencoder. So, what is an autoencoder? So, the name indicates it is self-encoding. Auto. So it encodes itself. See, normally in a neural network, we'll be having one input X and then an output. So the output will be Y. Even in class labels, we say the input is X and then the output is. So here, the inputs and outputs will be different. Inputs and outputs are different in case of any neural network. But autoencoder, it tries to reproduce itself. So first of all, it is an unsupervised representational learning. It implements unsupervised and representational learning. So here, the neural networks are subject to the task of representation learning. What do you mean by representation learning? We impose a bottleneck in the network, which forces the compressed knowledge representation of the input. So the given input is reduced to a lower dimension. So we just learn a lower dimensional. So we can say compressed domain. So that compressed domain represents the salient features of the input. So that's why we got another characteristic of autoencoder is it's a powerful feature detector. It's able to detect features. But the basic requirement is the data is highly correlated. So otherwise, this is not possible. We all know that in compression, we can perform compression only if there is redundancy or a high correlation among data. Normally, we know that images are highly correlated, so autoencoders can be very well used for image compression. So here, this autoencoder is an unsupervised learning network because we don't provide any labels, class labels. We just give raw data. Here, we impose a bottleneck in the network, so that produces a compressed domain. or lower dimensional representation. And also, you can see that the number of nodes in the input layer is same as the output layer. So generally, it has, you could see that is the size of the inputs. So this is the process. So we give the input image. So it passes through the encoding phase, and then it produces the code. So that code, we call it as a bottleneck layer or the code. That is a compressed code. Just the code is used to reconstruct the input. So input image and the reconstructed image. So it has three important components. Normally, a simple encoder has three layers. So a simple auto encoder has three layers: input layer, hidden layer, otherwise we call it as bottleneck layer, or the code layer. And then the last one is the output layer. So you could see that input layer is X. We train the network in such a way that the output X hat is similar to X. So again, it's very important to note that autoencoder is lossy. So it's gives lossy reconstruction. Otherwise, it learns an identity function. But normally, autoencoder will be its reconstruction is lossy. So we have three important. This is the basic structure of a simple autoencoder. So we have the input layer, that is X. So here W1 is the weights associated with the inputs. So we have the bottleneck layer. See, the bottleneck layer, the number of nodes, the bottleneck layer or the hidden layer will be less than that of the input layer. So it's you could see the number of nodes in the input layer and the output layer are the same, because this simple auto encoder is meant to reconstruct the input. So and you say is a this bottleneck layer, otherwise it's also called as the code layer. So what the encoder does, it compresses the given input into a latent space of usually smaller dimension. So let's say the encoder function is represented by H, that's equal to f of X. So the encoder function F, it converts the given input X into a lower dimensional representation H. So the function of decoder is to reconstruct the input from the latent space. So if you assume R is the reconstructed image, so that is the inverse of this, we apply the decoder function G. So G of f of X will be equal to R. And it is important to note that the R is as close to X as possible. So it's just an approximate version of the input. So the bottleneck layer or the code layer, is that it lies between the encoder and decoder, and it describes the code to represent the input. So this bottleneck layer or the code layer is very important because it represents the compressed version of the input. At the same time, the compressed version should represent, should be able to represent the entire input. That is, the decoder should be able to reconstruct the input with minimum loss, with minimal deviation, or with minimal distortion. So that is a special feature of autoencoder. So here, both the input and the outputs are the same. So it is meant to reconstruct the input. So a simple autoencoder has just three layers, but with other types of autoencoders, you can have any number of layers in between. That depends upon the application. So that is the pictorial representation. So encoder, code. So the purpose of the autoencoder is to generate a latent space representation of the input. So encoder, code, and the decoder. Now, what are our expectations from the autoencoder? So it should be able to accurately reconstruct the input signal. Another expectation is, the second expectation is, it should not memorize. So it's not memorized in the sense, it can easily copy the input to the output. Why do we need a bottleneck layer and then so much training? Just we can copy the input to the output layer. So, but that's not our aim. That's not our interest. So autoencoders, so should be capable of accurate reconstruction. At the same time, they should not memorize or overfit the training data. So we have two conflicting requirements from the autoencoder. So we all know that the neural network optimizes or it reconstructs the output with minimal error by minimizing the loss function. That is the difference between the output and the input. Here in this case, say if x is the input and x dash is the output, then loss will be calculated based on the difference between x and x dash. So the first term, so normally it will be having just the loss function. But we have one more requirement, that is it should not memorize or overfit the training data. So for that, we will be adding a regularizer component. So that regularizer component will force the autoencoder to learn the characteristics. So our aim is to learn the characteristics of the data or the characteristics inherent in the data, but not just copying. So for that, you'll be adding the regularizer. So these two requirements are met by using this function. So we are using the last function, but we are in addition to the last term, we are adding a regularizer component. So like L2 norm, so that we keep the, we don't allow the weights to go beyond, we don't allow the weights to go beyond a particular value, so that maintain the stability of the network. So is this the basic idea underlying the autoencoder? So we have three components: encoder, bottleneck or the code layer, and the decoder. Now we may ask, so the same time, and then especially the one of the important application, dimensionality reduction. So it's used for data compression. So one important application of autoencoder is dimensionality reduction. We have some standard algorithms earlier, that is PCA. I think most of you would have learned about PCA, that is principal component analysis. Now, what is the difference between principal component analysis and autoencoder? So, actually, PCA, principal component analysis, it projects the input data onto an eigenspace. So, it finds the eigenvectors. So, the eigenspace will be modeled in such a way that you'll be having the first eigenvector will be the one that that represents the highest eigenvalue. Likewise, you'll be having a set of eigenvectors arranged in the decreasing order of the eigenvalues. So PCA finds those principal components, that is the components having higher eigenvalues. So this number of eigenvectors matters, that corresponds to the compressed version. So how much you are able to reconstruct using the principal components. But one disadvantage with principal component analysis is it can perform only linear transformation. So I hope you all know what is linear transformation. That is the relationship between the input and the output is linear. But that is not quite but normally in a data there won't be only linear relationship. So, especially in complex unstructured data, especially in unstructured data, we can't expect there will be a linear relationship between the input and the output. So, for such applications, we may have to perform non-linear transformation. So, this PCA performs a linear transformation, and the cost function uses mean squared error, whereas autoencoder can perform both linear as well as non-linear transformation. It uses both mean squared error and binary cross entropy as loss functions. So loss functions are very important for any machine learning or deep learning model, because they are our objective is to minimize the loss in any model. So also autoencoder gives better accuracy, or it's efficient than PCA, as seen in the images. Now, what are the properties of an autoencoder? So autoencoders, the first property of an autoencoder, they'll be able to compress data similar to what they have been trained on, that is data specific. Suppose if you train the autoencoder with medical images, then they'll be very effective in compressing only medical images. So it works well for the data it has seen already. So if the autoencoder is trained for medical images, and if you are using the same thing for natural images, it won't give the same result. Or say if the images, if you provide data other than images, then the performance of the autoencoder will not be satisfactory. So it is data specific. They'll be able to compress data similar to what they have been trained on. Second property is lossy. So we'll not be able to perfectly reconstruct the input. We are trying to minimize the error, but the output will not be the exact version of the input. And then third property is learn automatically from examples. That is, it is easy to train specialized instances. And the it's also similar to data specific. It will perform well on a particular type of input. So the model is built only from the examples we use for the training set. But this property can be used for anomaly detection. Suppose we are training the model for a certain set of images, but if you are adding, say for example, you are trained an autoencoder for MRI images, for normal MRI images. But if you are testing with an MRI image with tumor, normally it will give a high reconstruction error, because it has detected some deviation, some new, some patch, additional patch in a particular area. So there will be high reconstruction error, which can be used. So that will signal that there is an anomaly in this input. So because our autoencoder is trained to reproduce the input, but if the error is high, then that means there is something which is not similar to the original one. So in that case, we can take it as an anomaly. So in this way, autoencoders are used for anomaly detection. Now, what are the design parameters of an autoencoder? There is a code size, so the number of nodes in the middle layer. So again, that depends. A smaller size results in more compression. So there are no hard and fast rules in specifying the number of nodes in the hidden layer. So that depends on the application. Suppose if you don't want to have perfect reconstruction, say for example, if it is a medical image analysis means, then you have to give priority to the error. That is, there should be perfect reconstruction of the input image. And then similarly, if you are extracting features, right? So which will be using for reconstruction or for generating new kind of image again. So there are some applications where you need perfect reconstruction of the input image. So in that case, so the number of nodes in the middle layer, so that depends upon the application, the requirement of the application. So far we don't have a particular number. So this number of nodes are required. But in general, if you want to have a compressed version, then the number of nodes in the middle layer should be less than the number of nodes in the input layer. So that is our that's the bottom line of this design of autoencoder. But the number of nodes, increase in the number of nodes or decrease depends upon the application or the requirement of the application. And then the number of layers. So a simple autoencoder has three layers: one input layer, one bottleneck layer or code layer, and one output layer. But there can be any number of layers. So we have deep autoencoders with more number of layers. There is stacked autoencoders. And the number of nodes per layer, if you look at the number of nodes, or if you look at the architecture of the if you look at the architecture of any autoencoder, you could see the number of nodes. So in the input nodes here, it has 6, and then 4, and then 2, and then the encoder part, and then on the other side, decoder, again, it has 4, and then 6. So they have a symmetric structure. Both the encoder and the decoder has symmetric layer structure. So the number of nodes in the middle layers, again, that depends on the application. Okay, so the design parameters. So the number of nodes per layer decreases with each subsequent layer of the encoder and increases back in the decoder. So as I said, as we have seen, the decoder is symmetric to the encoder in terms of the layer structure. And then normally, autoencoder either uses mean squared error or binary cross entropy, depending upon the type of the input. If it is binary, we use cross entropy, otherwise mean squared error. So what are the acceptable values for those parameters? Again, as I said, the code size, smaller size results in more compression. And then the number of layers, it can have many layers, loss function. And then the number of node per layers, again, that depends on the application. That depends upon the there is input data. So number of nodes per layer, because the number of nodes per layer will depend on the input we feed. So if it is a digit image, then it will be 28 by 28. It will have 784 nodes. If it is some other application, the number of nodes, the input layer, again, you know, in neural network, we just come across overfitting and underfitting problem. So normally the size of the training set we choose will be 60 to 70%. That is 70% is training and 30%. And nowadays we are using say 80-20 also. So overfitting is, we have low training set error and then high test set error. So it gives a low error when you are running the model using the training set. And then it gives more error when you use the test set. So that is overfitting. So for that, we normally we would love to have low training set error and low test error. So the solution to overfitting in autoencoders is, we'll be adding L2 regularization term to the objective function. L2 regularization is nothing but the Euclidean norm. So we'll be adding L2 to the objective function. What is our objective function? In any neural network model, the objective function is to minimize the loss function. So in addition to the loss function, we'll be adding a regularization. And then second solution is, see, normally overfitting means the model is too complex with too many parameters, right? So we try to avoid or to reduce overfitting. We'll be using regularizer. We'll be regularizing the network by reducing the number of parameters, reducing the number of nodes, reducing the number of layers. So here the solution to is, we just tie the weights of the encoder and decoder. Do you know what you mean by tying the weights of the encoder and decoder? Here, the decoder weights are exactly the transpose of the encoder weights. So it's kind of parameter sharing. So if you have the encoder weights, if you just assume the encoder weight as W1, then the corresponding weight in the decoder will be W1 dash. So just a W1 transpose. So the weights of the encoder and the decoder are tied up. So they are just the transpose of the encoder weights. So there is a, you need not, the model need not memorize too many weights. So it's a kind of parameter sharing by that we can reduce overfitting. Now we have many types of autoencoder, each having cool applications or interesting applications. So the first one is under complete autoencoder, which we discussed so far. That is the basic autoencoder. So in under complete autoencoder, the bottleneck layer, the number of nodes in the bottleneck layer or the code layer will be less than, will be of low dimension than the input layer. So it's specially meant for compression. So reducing, you are getting a low dimensional representation of the input. Let's see one by one. So under complete autoencoder is to capture the most important features. That is the salient features. So it's a compressed, you can say it's a compressed domain because the data is represented in a lower dimensional space. So normally when the data is projected onto a lower dimension, the network will be able to learn important features. So how it works, it's just a simple normal autoencoder, normal neural network. It just works, it tries to minimize the loss function further from, so that the loss is computed. Let's show the diagram. So here you could see the input layer and the output layer. So we have the inputs. So the encoder will be assigning some weights, and then it is passed, the inputs are passed through the bottleneck layer, and then again the trained weights. So the, you know that this W1 and W1 are this transpose decoder weights. Decoder weight W1 is the transpose of W1. So we get the output, that is X hat. So this under complete autoencoder will try to minimize the loss, that is the squared loss between the input and the output. So here we compare the output with the input. So because the desired label, desired output is itself is X. So this MSE means squared error. So this under complete autoencoder will have less number of neurons or less number of nodes in the bottleneck layer and compared to the input. So normally all, most of the autoencoders, all types will have less number of neurons in the bottleneck layer. So under complete is a standard, is a common type of autoencoder. It's meant for low dimensional representation, and it's well suited for data compression. Now deep autoencoder, it's like, I can say it's a stacked autoencoder, both are same. So we have several autoencoders stacked together. So the first layer, so it will have multiple layers. The first layer will learn, will extract first order features. Second layer, some patterns. And then the third layer, even higher order features. So we could say edges, combination of edges and the object models. So we have, it's like, it's similar to normal neural network. But the, so the stacked autoencoder or deep autoencoder. So it's a input. So W1, and then again the second layer, yeah, weights W2. So this, the middle one is the bottleneck layer. Again, the transpose of the decoder, we have the transpose of weight W2. So we have more than one layer, so we call it a stacked autoencoder. Now autoencoder pre-trained. So in case of deep encoders, so the one major problem is we have more number of layers, so more number of nodes, so more number of weights to operate. So that increases the complexity. So each time we train, so during each epoch, so the train time will be higher. For that, what Hindu is, which is, we assume each one as a auto encoder, a simple auto encoder. See the first one, you could see the inputs, so it trained, and then the weights are given. So that is the output of this auto encoder one. So the Z1 is the output of the auto encoder one. Now just the next time the encoder will not iterate, will not consider the first layer, first the output of the first auto encoder. So this Z1 is taken as the input for the second auto encoder, that is AE2, and then the output will be Z2. So once Z2 has been found out, so the difference between Z2 and Z1 will be found. So that is over. Now these weights are transferred to the next auto encoder, AE3. So again, now we have AE3, that is it has its own bottleneck layer, that is the code layer, and then the output layer. So like this, we just train the network layer by layer. We call this as auto encoder pre-training. So we perform pre-training layer by layer, but finally, we can fine-tune these weights by doing end-to-end. So by this, we are reducing the complexity, we are reducing the training time, because each time we need not update all the weights. We just consider several autoencoders. So the output of the first autoencoder will be fed as input to the second autoencoder. Now we'll be focusing only on the second one. Likewise, we pre-train, and then using those weights, finally, after completing training all the layers, we just do one end-to-end from the first layer to the last layer. By this, we can improve the accuracy. So this is this one important technique in the auto encoders, this pre-training. The second next type of auto encoder is denoising auto encoder. So this has a large number of applications. Denoising auto encoder. Actually, in normal auto encoder, we give the input and then we train to reproduce the same input as output. But what we do in denoising auto encoder is we corrupt the input. We corrupt the input by adding some noise. This is one of the important application for image quality enhancement. This denoising auto encoders can be well suited for quality enhancement. So we just perturb the input by adding some noise. It could be any type of noise, salt and pepper or Gaussian noise to the input image. And then the autoencoder is what it does is in a normal autoencoder, we just try to compare. We try to minimize the error, that is X minus X bar, that is X bar or X hat is the output. But here, X is the input. Now, after adding some noise, let us assume that noisy image as X tilde. Now, in our training, we will not compute the loss between X hat and the X tilde, that is the noisy image. We'll be finding the loss between the X hat and X original input. So, I'll show you. Okay, you could see better representation here. So I'm having X. Let us assume these are the inputs. Say if we are giving binary inputs, you can flip the inputs. You can flip a percentage of bits in the input to either say flip means 1 to 0 or 0 to 1. So we are just introducing some noise by changing the value, right? And then I am feeding to this is the bottleneck layer. Here you can see the more number of nodes in the bottleneck layer, but here in denoising auto encoder, there is no limit, there's no condition that the number of nodes should be less than the input layer. So here, this just we apply a function, right? And then finally we get the decoder produces the output X hat. Now the error is computed. Normally what we do is we'll be computing the error between xi tilde and xi hat. But here we just find, compute the error between the original input and the output. So here we just, so by this the autoencoder will be trained to produce image that is without noise. So we are removing noise. So in this case, the objective is to reconstruct the original image from the corrupted image. So we are we are giving the input, that the input is corrupted image but the output is the original image, because we are computing the error function between the corrupted the output and the input image. So we are training, so it's a kind of, that's why we call it as denoising autoencoder. So in this case, another thing is it cannot memorize the input, because here the input and the output are different, because the input is the original image, sorry, input is the corrupted image and the output is the original image. So here the inputs and the outputs are different. So an advantage of denoising autoencoders is that it will not memorize the input. So this model learns a vector field. We call it as a manifold. So for mapping the input data towards a lower dimensional manifold that describes the original data. Actually, manifold is a dense representation of the input image. So the model maps the input to a lower dimensional image space, and then which is used to construct, or which is used to reconstruct image without noise. So it is better for removing noise. So here, so if you see this, this is the blue one is the that is a pixels in the original image, all x. Now this in the original x we are adding some noise, so it becomes x tilde. So this denoising autoencoder will try to pull or to bring back this x tilde towards this, like this non-linear mapping, that is the original data. So all corrupted pixels. So the original pixel is x, the corrupted pixel is x tilde. So this denoising autoencoder tries to bring the corrupted pixel to back to its original form. So this because the last function is computed between the output and the original input. So that's denoising autoencoder. So that's examples for binary data. So in this case, you can have some percentage, just a percentage of, say here in this example, Q number of bits are flipped, and then the remaining bits, 1 minus Q, will be having the same value. So we try to minimize the error between x hat minus xij, not x tilde. So by this we try to remove noise in the input image. So it's a denoising autoencoder. So we could see the output. There is the data, and then the filters using autoencoder, and then here this another MA output with using weight decay filters. Both are autoencoders. That is a regularized filter using regularized filter. So here the output is denoising output of denoising autoencoder using Gaussian noise. So we can use autoencoders for visualization. What do you mean by visualization? So we can think of each neuron as a filter, that is which fire for a certain input configuration. So already we have trained the autoencoder, so we just trace back, like backtracking. So for this particular neuron, so say for example, if you take this blue neuron, what configuration of what input configuration of xi makes this particular neuron to fire. So that's how we are able to visualize. So this, we know that each neuron will represent a particular feature, right? So each neuron will fire for a particular feature in the input. So different neurons in the hidden layer will fire for different edge patterns, right? So it will be easy, that is to visualize. So which has a great effect, which pattern actually fires a particular neuron in the hidden layer, right? So that is another application of denoising autoencoder for visualization, for visualizing the impact of the input on a particular neuron. So this is another example, but this image is not, that is pulmonary nodule feature extraction. So using denoising autoencoder, we get a feature map, and then the feature map. So there is another application of this denoising autoencoder. So the feature maps extracted can be given as input to another MLP, that is a multilayer perceptron, so for a classifier. So now this will be very useful in case of semi-supervised learning. Say for example, if we have a set of we have a large number of data which are not labeled, unlabeled data, we have a small amount of labeled data, right? So normally for effective training, we need more number of data. So in that case, what you can do is, you can do unsupervised learning using autoencoders, that is denoising autoencoders with this unlabeled data, and then you can feed that output as input to a supervised, that is to a neural network layer or supervised learning. We know the labels, right? So this is a combination of unlabeled data and labeled data, is called a semi-supervised learning, because we just extract the features using denoising autoencoder, extract the features we need to understand one thing. This autoencoders is not exclusively meant for reproducing the input, right? So it's not used only for reconstruction purpose. If you throw the decoder part, that could be used for many applications. So the encoded version, that is the encoded output from the encoder of any autoencoder, can be used for many applications. So likewise here, this encoder can be directly connected to another multilayer perceptron for classification. So this will be helpful, especially for this unlabeled data. So this unsupervised learning will give you some features that will be helpful to classify the unlabeled data. So it's a combination of supervised and unsupervised learning. And then another, the next type is contractive autoencoder. So contractive. So the contractive autoencoder is based on the principle that similar inputs have similar activations. So we have the input. So this we are trying to exploit. That's a neighborhood. We know that neighborhood pixels are highly correlated. So that is the principle behind any compression. So this contractive and autoencoder is also based on, that is, or you can say neighborhood pixels. So similar pixels have similar activations. So the difference between the activations of neighboring neurons will also be small. So the contractive autoencoder exploits that principle, right, by contracting a neighborhood of inputs to a small neighborhood of outputs. It is based on the assumption that similar inputs have similar activations, and then the difference also will be less. So we can contract the neighborhood of inputs to a smaller neighborhood. So for that we'll be using some will be penalizing, that is, will be adding some function. That is, excuse me. So you could see this diagram. So all similar inputs. So the similar inputs are contacted to a constant. You can say the training examples x1, x2, x3. These are the observations. Now all similar inputs are constrained. They are forced to be have a constant value. They are contacted to a constant output within a neighborhood. Right, so this linear identity function. So it's based on the principle that is exploiting the correlation between neighborhood pixels. So just omitted the mathematics part of this contactive encoder, but you can understand just the basic principle. This is the thing: similar inputs produce similar activations. So that similar activations, that is, all similar activations can be cease to fall to a particular constant value. By that, we are able to contact a particular set of neighborhood. The next important autoencoder is convolutional autoencoder, that is based on convolutional neural networks. We all know that the convolutional neural networks uses a set of filters to extract a feature map. Right, so this multiple feature maps can be combined or stacked together to get the desired patterns at the output layer. So we use the same principle, conventional autoencoder, and then they use those features to reconstruct the output. So that is conventional autoencoder. So let's see the example. So we have So it's convolutional autoencoder. We have one or more convolution layers and then deconvolution layers. So actually, it's not deconvolution or transpose convolution. So the encoder and then the decoder. So encoder has one or more convolution layers, and then the reverse of this process, convolution process, we call it as transpose convolution. So based on that, we are able to reproduce the handwritten digit. So you could see the pictorial representation too. So it's a simple convolutional network, but in the middle, the bottleneck layer will be having a low dimensional representation. Again, it is upsampled and then reshaped, and then we apply a transverse convolution to recognize the digit too. So it's a regular convolution. You could see nine element matrix is reduced to 4, and then here transpose convolution, you could see it is expanded, it's upsampled. So this convolutional autoencoder, and I just got it from one video. So we have here we are training the convolutional autoencoder to recognize only the cat images, right? So we have the cat images, and then we train it. So we have here we have the input layer, and then we have convolution layer, max pooling layer. Hope you all know your convolutional neural network will have a set of set of convolution layer, activation layer, and then max pooling or pooling layer. It could be either max pooling or min pooling or average pooling. So it's just a convolutional neural network, and then you could see three layers: the input layer, set of convolution layers, and then core layer in the middle, that is max pooling. So max pooling actually downsamples So it reduces, it produces a low dimension one, and then again the decoder. So decoder is the transpose convolution. We perform transpose convolution, and then finally we get the output layer. So we build the model, we compile it, and then let's see what will be the output of this. Yeah. So these are the original cats, and then the encoded cats. See how far we are able to reduce. We are able to get the compressed version of the original cats, and then the interesting part is we are able to reconstruct the hat using the encoded one. So, but there is some error. You could see it's not perfect reconstruction as we expected. So we can use convolutional neural network for encoding. That's another application of convolutional neural networks. So it could be used for image reconstruction, image colorization. I'll show you some images so that you may understand. So here, classifier, another application of autoencoder, classifier built on top of autoencoders. That's what I told you. We will be training an autoencoder, right? We just throw the decoder part and then feed the encoded version to another neural network or directly to the output layer of a classifier. So just using the features, we are able to classify. Thereby, we are able to construct a classifier. So what is the advantage of this type of classifier? We are minimizing the training time. We are minimizing the training time and complexity of the classifier. So variational autoencoder is another type, but we need a separate session for describing this variational autoencoder because it has a good number of applications. So what it does is it splits the bottleneck layer into encoding and confidence. So if you see the diagram, you could see that the bottleneck layer is split up into mean and variance. It is and then the final encoding is done by sampling both mu and this variance. So variational autoencoder are capable of generating new images because they are able to separate features encoded in separate neurons. So they will be able to identify the features encoded by each neuron. So based on that, they are able to construct or generate new images. So variational autoencoder is another interesting application of autoencoders that we shall discuss. We don't have enough time for discussing in detail. So it's a simple autoencoder. How we build a simple digit autoencoder? We have the, you know, that simple autoencoder has only three layers: input layer, hidden layer, and then code layer. So we are using the ReLU activation function. So this is a binary. We are using binary cross entropy as the input, as the last function. Sorry. So we have the original data. There is a original data. And then have this. So the next one is, you say an example for denoising autoencoder. You could see the original data, encoded data, and then finally decoded data. So this is encoded one, the middle one. So the applications of autoencoders: denoising, dimensionality detection, image coloring, feature variation. Can remove watermarks, you can compress data, and then can detect anomalies, and then for information retrieval, and then finally image generation, that is by using variational autoencoders. So dimensionality reduction. So image coloring. So the reconstructed image. Here is the original one, and then the reconstructed image, and then finally we are adding some colors. So the for image coloring, we are using auto encoders, and then for feature variation, extracts only the required features. So we could see in the input, at the output, it is able to remove the white spot. So it could be used the denoising auto encoder. Watermark removal is another application, and then for image quality enhancement. So you know, that's a good example. So here you have the Taj Mahal image where there are some black patches, but auto encoders are able to, from the compressed version or the low dimensional latent space version, they are able to reconstruct. The decoder is able to reconstruct the image. So auto encoders can be used as feature descriptors. So like you know, feature descriptors, because the encoded version, that is the code layer, will give you the features, the description of the, it gives you the description or the feature description of the input. So for object recognition, we have the query image. So just extract the features using auto encoders, and those features can be used to search. So thereby reducing, minimizing the search time. So image retrieval is a good application. It's one of the applications of auto encoders. So these are the tools you may need for, see, for, we don't need a special function or tool to construct the neural, that is auto encoders. Just like any other network, you'll be using the layers. You'll be adding the layers and then construct the auto encoder. So the essential tools and the data sets and the references. So if, I think I have left out one auto encoder, that is sparse auto encoder. So that sparse encoders, they also provide an alternate way of introducing information. That is providing a compressed domain, that is a compressed representation, but without reducing the number of nodes. I think, I don't know whether I crossed it. I think somewhere So there in sparse auto encoders, we use a sparsity constant. So we use a sparsity constant. So I'll just explain, I don't have the slide, but sparse auto encoders, they work like, they don't reduce, the bottleneck layer will not have reduced number of nodes. They'll have more number of nodes, more number of hidden neurons, but we introduce a sparsity constant or sparsity constraint. So to control the number of active neurons in the hidden layer. So not all the neurons will be activated. So we are regularizing the activations. This is sparse, by using the sparse encoder. By that we are able to, normally when we have less number of neurons in the hidden layer, we'll be able to learn more features. So the sparse encoders, auto encoders, they does the sparse encoders, they do the same, but without removing the number of nodes in the hidden neuron, but having the same number of neurons, same number of new nodes as the input, or more number of neurons than the input, but we just select neurons, we just activate some neurons by introducing the sparsity constraint. So that is another auto encoder which I have left, which I have not shown in this PowerPoint. So hope, I think it's a new topic for me as well. So I have tried my level best to give an overview of the auto encoders. So basically auto encoders are used for reproducing the input for reconstruction, but that many applications are possible just by discarding the decoder. So decoder is used only to check the accuracy of the encoder, whether it has been trained well. So once we have assured, once we have tested its performance, then the encoder part, the output of the encoder part can be used for several applications like classification, image segmentation. Suppose if you give all the pixels as the input or the image patches as the input, then the output will be the parts having tissue patches, that is a features, special features that will be able to, that will help us to segment the given image. So it is a better, it has better application in classification, segmentation, image quality enhancement, image generation, compression and compression. So it has a lot number of applications for the researchers to explore more. So I request all the researchers who are working in this domain to explore this particular topic, autoencoders. So with this, I complete my session. So if there are any questions, I can answer.
Thank you, madam.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, colleague.
Okay, participants. Okay, madam. I think they were posted maybe through the feedback link. We can conclude the session, I think. Okay. So on behalf of this organizing committee, I thank you very much, madam.